was saying, you know, when we describe Bernard as the chief executive, it's usually because somebody from on high requires a piece of paper, and every other day she's just chief butler washer. And then they lock me in a room every now and again. They get to do Rumpelstiltskin and try and turn what we do into funding applications for doing some more of it. What I wanted to do to contribute to today's conversation was to look at three, mindful that this is a short contribution, and not wanting to raise the wrath of the chair should I waffle on as usual forever. I wanted to focus on some examples that give you an idea of how STEP works. The organisation STEP stands for South Tyrone Empowerment Programme actually started at the end of the conflict and was not an organisation set up to address the question of immigration and rights-based integration of new people into our community. It was set up as a way of addressing the conflict in the neighbourhoods and the society in which we lived post the struggle. So I'm not going to go into how that actually came about, but quite weirdly, in many ways, that long story ends up that STEP became a network of people who had effectively been left out of the war. Doesn't mean people who hadn't been involved in the war, but the conflict in the north basically categorised only two kinds of people. It didn't matter what other identification marker you might have, you had to go into either the Catholic nationalist box or the Protestant unionist box. So if you were a gay person, if you were a person with a disability, if you were a gay person with a disability, it didn't matter. You only really went into one of these boxes. So it was that idea of ensuring that at the end of conflict, the opportunities for a different kind of participation and democracy and equality that was based within Section 75 of the government, the new peace government of Ireland Act, which always interested us. It was the 75th most important thing. That's where equality sat in the peace in Northern Ireland. It was the 75th right idea on a list of potential ways of improving our society. So that's where we started. But the theory behind what we were doing as well was that several people, because they had nothing else really to do, had read Boutros Boutros-Ghali's Agenda for Peace, which very clearly set out that if you are actually going to build a sustainable peace, it had to be embedded at all the different levels of society simultaneously. And those of us who had read it had problems with the way it was being implemented in the top layers. So we thought the one thing we felt we could contribute was to build along the bottom so that if the whole thing fell apart, which looks like might happen, the ability of the people who led us into a circular conflict to lead us back into it would be seriously minimalised, and that people would have a better concept themselves on which to make better informed decisions about how things would go. So we are in the middle of this wonderful experiment, and one of the great opportunities that arose from the end of violence, from political and social stability, one of the biggest economic opportunities arising from the peace was the inward migration of new people to an expanded labour market. So that's where STEP began. And because of the way we were working on rights-based equality and rights-based integration, purely in a local sense, people who'd always lived there, the way we were working wasn't a problem. The way we were working was proved to be a good way of working because we were able to just very smoothly extend that on into the next group of people and groups of people who came into the neighbourhoods and with whom we then began to work again around equality and integration. But fundamentally, we're a human rights organisation. And then people will say, oh, you're not really, because you don't really study the law and you don't get to Geneva and you're really, you know, you're really do it yourself amateur human rights organisation. And we say, we take that. So we work on a very, very simple basis, which I think is a theory around it. It's called the implementation of science. But it works at a very ground level. Is it doesn't matter how many great ideas you have. People can't benefit from them if they are not implemented on the ground so people's lives are improved by them. So you can have all the rights and all the bits of paper that you want, but if people can't actually make them work on an everyday basis to improve their own lives, it's very difficult for people to see how they work. So I just want to look at a couple of examples of things that we do that explain how we do it. Because just as you were saying about a dual approach of building community resilience and capacity and enabling communities to find and negotiate their own solutions alongside human rights, we see that as an integrated holistic piece of work. So it's not a duality. It's an integrated piece of work that every step forward is based on that. So I'll give you one example. So a couple of cases that we're working on in a minute. A young 15-year-old boy. His mum and dad came to see us because they had a problem. And the first problem they had, this lad's doing his GCSE this year. He's only 2 weeks into school. He's got a detention and he's got a one-day exclusion. And the reason that he has got those is that he has actually got into a row with a number of other boys in the school. So his parents come to us because they're very concerned. And we know as soon as we see them coming, because we've seen it before. We could tell mum and dad why this young lad's temper has broken and why he has finally retaliated and found himself on the wrong side of school. He's 5 years in school. And the first day he stepped into the school, he has been the victim of racist harassment and racist bullying. But nobody names it. Nobody names it. Because schools have bullying policies and anti-bullying policies, but nobody acknowledges the reality. And the reality is that children who are different are likely, unless children are themselves educated and encouraged to behave differently, children will behave like the adults around them. And if the adults around them are intolerant of diversity and difference and different colour of skin and different accents and people coming from different places, so too with the children. They learn that behaviour from their mothers and their fathers and their neighbours and their teachers and the lady who serves the dinner and the person who cleans the school. And they absorb it. So we're dealing with that case at the minute, and we're in a very good position because over 10 years of starting with the problem, and as we say, it's like getting your hand on a piece of string and you pull it. One thing that we're sure of is these children have rights. Every child has a right. And people forget that human rights are a very individual concept. It is the individual person who holds these rights. They're not rights for certain groups of people. Every single human being is entitled to exactly the same right. What is different is the things that impact on certain groups of people to mean that they are further away from people who belong in that group having access to equal rights. So immigrants and people of color, women, people with disability, are human beings with the same right as people who don't have disability, as people who aren't black, as people who aren't brown, as people who are born here. They have the same kind of rights, but just infinitely harder for them to reach them. So we get on that piece of string together and we pull and we pull, and there we say there are two kinds of people in this world. Those who have rights, and there are duty bearers. Somewhere along this piece of string is somebody, not something, but somebody whose job it is to protect your right. Not those big rights. We're not talking the United Nations here. We're talking somebody who has a name and who has a job. Part of their job is to protect your right in this particular matter. And we just keep going and we keep going. So if we find group solutions for what are individual problems. So I'm very happy to say that in the case of David, where we now have David's mum and dad coming to us, David's not his real name, but David's mum and dad coming to us, there is already a protocol in place. We have an anti-bullying forum that is placed within the National Children's Bureau, and once we notify, which we do, once we notify the anti-bullying coordinator of racist bullying in a school, from the bottom right to the top, everybody responsible for children in that particular school is notified that they now have a rights-based responsibility to solve that problem. And what changed the loop for us was that we used to run in a circle, was that we have now got that embedded within the ombudsman, the ombudsperson for education. So at the very start, everybody knows this is going to the ombudsman if this isn't sorted. Everybody knows this is the time frame, this is what has to happen. If this doesn't happen, this is where this is going. And we call it, in step, because there's an urge around about it, don't care was made to care. Because people up here don't care until they're made to care. Maybe take just another brief example again of the work that we do. We don't have, because the nature of asylum is different in the North of Ireland, because it's not a devolved matter. Immigration and asylum, therefore, is based in London. Northern Ireland is known within the United Kingdom as a point of last resort. I don't know if they do that in a whole area of things, but in terms of asylum and refugee location, it's a point of last resort. So most of the people we would have who are asylum seekers within the Northern Ireland will be people who have come directly into the North, usually coming up through the south, because if people come into the UK first and claim political asylum, they will be unlikely to reach Northern Ireland. But if people come to Northern Ireland before making the claim, it's a much smaller group of people, and they will be processed within the Northern Ireland. To make life easy for bureaucrats, that group of people are almost exclusively retained within the city of Belfast. Now, those of us who live outside of the city of Belfast think that might be a violation of human rights in itself. Anybody has to be forced to live in the city of Belfast when the rest of the country is, from our point of view, much more civilised. Through the Syrian programme, which is a very small programme, the United Kingdom declined to participate within the broad European Union Syrian programme, and they have their own. So within these very specific Syrian resettlement program, we do have a part to play in Northern Ireland in doing that. And we've had a small victory there in saying, look, the bureaucracy shouldn't work the same way because the people are not seeking political asylum. They have already been through that process in the camps in Lebanon and Jordan. They're retained in the camps until the refugee process is completed. So these people have refugee status, so they should be entitled to relocate anywhere in the north. And we've been able to ensure that the Mid-Ulster Council is willing and able to take and offer new opportunities to Syrian refugees. And part of that issue, and we've had our first small number of Syrian families relocate into Dungannon area. And taking your point, there are alternatives. People want to come. People are people, they want to rebuild their lives. They want to work, and people come with history and skills and strengths that are more than we've got because they got themselves here. People who managed to get, economic migrants who managed to get from Guinea-Bissau to Dungannon are smarter than people in Dungannon.
Enrichment of who they are,
and an enrichment of who we are. And last week we said, do you know what, we must be doing it right. National Geographic magazine turned up in the end to say, this is a very strange town, because it's a rural town. It had a population of 15,000 10 years ago. It has a population of nearly 17,000 now in the town proper. The underarms have extended. Over that period of time, the number of new people immigrating is now 10% of the population. We survived a recession because we had plenty of people to live in accommodation. Our rural schools aren't closing. They're staying open. Our young graduates aren't leaving. And the food has significantly